So the Center for Early Childhood Education is a research and training institute here on campus that focuses on early childhood. And we are looking at how children learn, how teachers can best help children learn, and then how teacher education programs and professional development programs can best support teachers in teaching children. One of our goals is to sponsor workshops and conferences and speakers like our speaker today to expand the field's understanding of issues impacting young children and those who work with young children. So I'm very pleased today to be able to bring Lisa Guernsey here as part of our University Hour speaker. Her topic of discussion today is critically important to anyone who studies, who works with, or who has their own young children. So I'd like to introduce Lisa. She is a senior policy analyst at New America Foundation, which is a nonpartisan think tank and incubator for explanatory and investigative journalism on pressing policy issues. She's a regular contributor to the Early Ed Watch blog. Ms. Guernsey's been writing about education for nearly 15 years, focusing on the intersections of social science, education, and technology. She worked for several years as a technology reporter for the New York Times, where she wrote about the social and educational impact of technology in stories about laptops for middle schoolers, leapfrog talking books, online grades, and other trends. She's written articles for national publications such as the Washington Post and Consumer Reports, and she wrote the Baby Steps column for Baby Talk magazine, where she highlighted new findings by developmental psychologists on how infants and toddlers learn. She served as assistant editor for the Chronicle of Higher Education, where she covered technology and academe, digital publishing, and online courses. In 2001, she was a media fellow at Duke University's DeWitt Wallace Center for Media and Democracy. And in 2005, she was a journalism fellow in the Child and Family Policy Program at the University of Maryland. After the birth of her second child in 2004, Ms. Guernsey began doing more in-depth research about screen media and infants, toddlers, and preschoolers. Her investigation took her to research laboratories around the country, and she interviewed a whole host of experts, language acquisition experts, developmental psychologists, cognitive scientists, educational psychologists, communication scholars, and social workers. She met with producers of children's videos and designers of computer software for children. And the result of her two-year quest to learn all she could about how screen media affects young children is the 2007 book, Into the Minds of Babes, How Screen Time Affects Children from Birth to Five, which we happen to have right over here. This is really an insightful, informative read, and it's one that I have personally recommended to colleagues in the field of early childhood, as well as to friends of mine who have young children. I would recommend it highly. Ms. Guernsey lives in Alexandria, Virginia, with her husband and two daughters, and she has a master's in English and American Studies from the University of Virginia. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Lisa Guernsey.
Thank you very much. That was a very kind introduction. I really appreciate the invitation to come here and to be able to talk with all of you. Before I get started, I would love to just kind of get a sense of who's out there. And I know a lot of you are students. I was wondering if you could raise your hand if any of you have children or work with children under the age of six right now. Okay, great. And then if any of you are parents, anyone parents out there? Okay, great. That gives me a good sense. So what I'll be talking about today is often called screen time, and that's the new kind of euphemism for the time that children spend in front of screens, not only television sets, but also in front of their computers or, you know, watching DVDs, as well as even screens on, you know, iPhones, when they're, say, watching videos on iPhones with their parents or on their own. And so there's a lot of discussion out there about screen time these days. It's really a hot topic. It's also quite a controversial one. And it's one that gives parents a lot of angst and anxiety about, oh, what's too much? So what what I found in my research is that we really just need to get smart about screen time, and that's what I'll be talking to you about today. You had the introduction, and these are my kids. So I'm mom, and in addition to being a journalist and a writer, and when I was working on my book, my kids look like this. They're older now, but I've got two young girls, and as anyone who works with young children know, you know, it's not necessarily as easy as you think. You know, kids can be tough, and they're a huge amount of fun, but they're also they're changing all the time, and these guys are too. When I started doing the research on this book, it basically came out of my quest to understand more about my own kids and what they were getting out of screen time. But it also came from all of this decade of research that I had been doing just as a regular journalist, thinking about how technology affected family life and the way children, parents, teachers and children all interacted together. And this is what I looked like. This, aside from the fact that my hair is not blonde, I was kind of a frazzled mom when I started kind of getting into this. So I was one of those folks who, at this point I had a newborn and a two-year-old. This is 2004 when I started really getting deep into this. And on the one hand, I was hearing a lot of messages from particularly the medical community and pediatricians to just turn off all screen time. Don't let your kids go anywhere near videos. ADHD is a possibility. You know, we've seen links between attention deficit problems and children who watch too much TV at young ages. And just a lot of alarms going off in the popular press and in health sections of newspapers and on the Today Show, et cetera. But on the other hand, another side of me was hearing, partly through marketing of videos by manufacturers and partly through TV and also through the new research that was coming out, that video and other kinds of DVD products could stimulate my babies and my kids and my toddlers. They could give them a better, broader sense of the world. They could really help them learn language. And I found myself really being pulled between these two poles and wondering, okay, what's the real truth out there? So here's what we know in terms of where screen media fits into the days, into the routine of today's children. And this is actually a relatively conservative estimate, but this is what I think is from some of the best research that's out there. The Kaiser Family Foundation is an organization based in Washington, D.C. and California, and they do surveys, national randomized surveys of parents on a fairly regular basis about media and children and health. And when I took their data, which shows that at about age three, children are spending 1 hour to 25 minutes with screens a day, and then added in some of the other data that they received on listening to music and being read to, and then put in some of what I also know from other research I've done and from my own kind of assumptions as a parent, I got this pie chart. And it shows that, you know, screen time, the green sliver there, is a fairly, you know, it's a fairly big chunk when you think about, say, what a child's day looked like 45 years ago. But it's not a huge, like, one-quarter slice the way we sometimes hear in the media. Often there's numbers out there like children are spending 3-4 hours a day in front of screens. And the problem with those numbers is that they're often collapsing all sorts of different age groups into one number. But if we're talking about the young children, you know, 5 and under, and in this particular case this is for 3-year-olds, it's not as dominant in their day, according to this national research, but it's not insignificant either. So that's just kind of a sense of where screen time is, and that includes DVDs, computers, although computers don't show up very much with 3-year-olds, and of course TV. One piece of that pie that's missing, though, is what might be happening in the background when children are playing, or even when they're sleeping, or even when they're eating. And what we do know from research from the Kaiser Family Foundation and many other reports is that background TV is prevalent in the homes of families with young children. And 53% of American families with young children have the TV on at least half the time, whether anyone is watching or not. And that number it's smaller, it's in the 40s for those that say that they have the TV on most or all of the time, but that's still a significant, really significant chunk of the American population that's basically living their life where they come into their homes and they turn on the light and then they turn on the TV. It's almost as automatic as turning on the light. So what does all this mean? So my question as a reporter and as a mother was, so if this is what the landscape is like out there for young children today, are they learning anything from it? Is there any really negative impact from it? What is this ADHD research actually all about? So I went to Beaker. I went to my bud. For me, actually, Beaker represents science. I mean, he's all about fun, but it's about just asking as many questions as you can, and that's what I wanted to do. So I decided to go to the science, and I spent several years going through journals like the Journal of Child Development, Infancy, Early Childhood Research Quarterly, as well as the Journals of Pediatrics, the Journal of American Medical Association, and many other communications journals that can give us the latest research findings on how media is impacting the way we see and understand the world. And what that research told me after I kind of spent a lot of time kind of poring over these minute details in these reports was, when you kind of got my head out of the deep blue sea, I came up and said, you know what? What this is really telling us is not what we're hearing in the media. What we're hearing in the media is the time matters so much, and it shouldn't be less than one, you know, it should be less than 1 hour a day, or it should be 0 minutes if you have a child under the age of 2. And it was all about the quantity of what was consumed. And yet the research actually points to how much the quality of what is consumed matters, and what's happening around that consumption matters. So I boiled it down to what I call the 3 C's. We need to be looking at content, context, and your child. And as I talk today a little bit, it'll be clear kind of what I mean by those 3 words. So I want, though, to have a couple moments of interactivity as I'm talking here today. And this is a good way for me to start learning some of the lingo, the developmental psychologist lingo around children and media, and to get into what we really know. So I want to ask you guys some quiz questions. And if you could just raise your hand if you think one of these might be the answer, and then we'll talk about what the real answer is. So, what do we think? When 12-month-old babies are shown a scrambled version of Teletubbies, do they, and first let me explain what I mean by scrambled. In this case, scrambled version of Teletubbies is one in which, say, imagine like in the old days where you had film. They chopped it, sliced it into a million little pieces, and reordered all of those little pieces of film so that it made no kind of logical linear sense. And in another case, one of the scrambled versions was one where they would run the words backwards. So a sound like something like NAF would be, or a fan would sound like NAF, would be run backwards. Okay, so what do babies do when they are shown a version like this? Do they giggle and scream? Anyone? Do they fall asleep? Do they tug on mom's sleeve to ask what's wrong with the TV set? Or do they show no sign of noticing that anything is amiss? Great. So most of you got this one right. Very good. They really don't even notice that there's something really messed up about what they're looking at. And what this is out of research, this is research that's out of the University of Massachusetts at Amherst, where they took 2 groups of babies, and they showed one group the regular Teletubbies, as we see it on PBS, and then they showed another group the scrambled version. And in both cases, there was no significant difference in the way the babies looked at the screen, whether they seemed to be paying any close attention to it at all. So this showed really no difference, as if the scrambled version meant as much to them as the regular one did. So that's a really kind of key piece of understanding when it comes to grasping what a 12-month-old baby, a 1-year-old baby, can perhaps get out of screen media. And the reason that I wanted to raise that is because it tells us a little bit about what background TV is when we're talking about the very youngest children. And at 12 months of age, almost everything that they're seeing, based on what we know so far about how babies understand media, almost everything that they're seeing is background TV to them, because it's not made for them. It's not made to be understandable to them. It's not something they're going to focus on. It's literally something that's kind of running in the background. background television, as I had mentioned earlier, you know, we've got 53% of American households that pretty much, you know, at least half the time have their TV on. Background TV is really where our conversation or our dialogue should be when it comes to media and kids today. From what I started to understand about the research, that's where we need to be kind of focusing some of our greatest attention, because that's where some of the strongest negative impacts are showing up. And yet, that's not necessarily what we're here. We're not hearing out there in the media or any other discussions any real distinction between background TV or foreground TV for children. And until we start making a distinction there, we're going to, a lot of the data that we're going to pull is going to be meaningless. Let me just tell you quickly, and we can get more into this in questions, which I'll, you know, hopefully I'll have some time for questions at the end, because there's a lot to say about background TV and what we know about it and why it may have some negative impacts. But there's three key studies right now on background TV and what it means for children. And in particular, in this case, I'm talking about children who are three and under. So we're talking about pretty young kids here. But there's been some work done, at the University of Massachusetts, that shows that background TV is interfering with the way children play. And as many of you who are maybe coming from the child development courses or in psychology know, play is really a key method for learning among young kids, among all of us, really. But it's critical at these young ages. So research is showing that if TV is going on in the background, in this case it was, say, Jeopardy, it was an adult program that was running in the background, 24-month-olds, 36-month-old children may not even be paying attention to that TV screen, and you may think, oh, well, it's not really affecting them at all. Instead, they're playing with their toys on the floor, perhaps in front of the TV, but the way they're playing is different than if the TV were off. Instead, they're spending shorter amounts of time with the toys on the floor. In one case that I saw, a child was playing with a little play school bus. And there are little figures, you know, you could put in and out of the bus, and you can kind of move it around and almost pretend that you were the bus driver. And children could spend a decent amount of time really kind of pretending with this toy when there was not TV going on in the background. But when there was Jeopardy playing, they still played, but they kind of just stopped and they would go on to something else. And then they would bop to another toy, and then they would bop to another. And their ability to kind of really get into their play, to build an inner dialogue about what they were talking about was being interfered with. Some other studies show TV and parent-child interaction, that background TV can really affect parent-child interaction. So it's kind of obvious, actually, that particularly if it's background TV that's something the parent wants to watch, like in my case, it was usually Food Network, where I had this baby, I had this toddler, I was like exhausted, I just need a second to give myself something else to think about, and I'm a Food Network fanatic, and so if I could just pop on Food Network for a little bit, and then, you know, it should keep the kids occupied with something else. But what we've been finding in a lot of the research on the way parents interact with their children is not that they're ignoring their kids at all when this is happening. Sure, they're still attending to them, they're answering their questions, but they're not necessarily taking the time to have a real full kind of conversation with them, to ask them some back and forth questions when the TV is on, rather when it's off. And then lastly, background noise and language development. Background noise has been shown to really affect the way children at very young ages, infants, the way they pick up language. There's a concept out there called segmenting speech, which means that even at 7.5, 8 months of age, a child is starting to understand that there are the units of sound in a stream of sound coming out of your mouth actually represent words, and they are hearing those words and starting to understand that they are associated with certain things. So the example I give a lot is, a mother who's always talking to her baby and saying, "Oh, I think you need a diaper change. I think you need a diaper change. Let's check that diaper." Well, even 7.5, 8-month-old infants have been shown in research that they can hear the word diaper as a unit of sound and start to understand that that actually relates to something. However, if there's background chatter going on, if there's a lot of noise that the kids are having to compete with, or the infants are having to compete with, they don't pick up that these are units of sound that actually correspond to words. And this segmenting of speech is something that's considered a real kind of cornerstone to speech and language development. So if we have a lot of households where the TV is running in the background a lot of the time, children may be having a really hard time just actually capturing units of speech out of what their parents are telling them, because they're having to kind of compete. They're having to filter out so much of what's going on around them. All right, so those are the studies. Pap quiz time again. There's this jargony word out there called pictorial competence. So what do we think? Is it A, young child's ability to draw a circle? Anyone? Is it B, a goal of illustrators and animators creating media for children? Is it C, a benchmark of symbolic understanding that shows up in children around 19 months of age? Some hands up there. Is it D, the ability to make a DVD package look so appealing that children start screaming for it in Target? That's what I should. So yeah, you guys got it. It's C. So let me explain a little bit more, though, right? Because that doesn't necessarily make a whole lot of sense. Benchmark of symbolic understanding, what is she talking about? Basically, what we know is that before a child is 1.5 years old or so, it may be very difficult for that child to hold two ideas in his or her mind. One idea might be that this is a pen. The other idea might be that this is, you know, a drawing of a pen, pathetic drawing, but they don't get that this actually represents this, because that means really having to hold these two concepts in their head at one time, and that may be very, very difficult from what we know for kids that age. And if they can't necessarily understand then what a symbol of something is, it can be very difficult, and this is, you know, we need a lot more research on this to understand, but the speculation will be, until we learn more about how kids understand symbols, that if they're not catching that something is a symbol of something, it's going to be really hard for them to catch that what media is, because media is essentially a symbol of something else, right? It's images or movement on screen that are representing something in real life. So without pictorial competence, it can be kind of tough for babies to be fully understanding what they're seeing on screen without some help. You know, if mom or dad are there talking to them about it. You know, and the research may show this in the future, because there's more research on that to come. And perhaps that'll change it. Let me give you a video that will kind of explain this a little bit, show what I mean. So that's research, this pictorial competence research comes out of both the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, and the University of Virginia, which is where Judy Deloche has been working. She's a psychologist who looks at how children understand symbols. And so she brought in a bunch of babies and sat them down in high chairs to see how they related to symbols in picture books. And she showed them books that had images of, say, a baby bottle or a rattle or a shoe. And then she wanted to see what are the babies gonna do when they see these pictures. And this is what she saw. And what we've got here, this is a 9-month-old boy. And instead of, you know, looking at it, saying, you know, maybe even pointing to it, he's trying to get that thing off the page. I mean, for him, it's all about grasping and trying to hold on to what he's seeing. And things are very much kind of about the concrete, physical thing at this age. So this is just, and she did studies with children of up to 24 months of age to see what they did. And by 19 months of age, instead of pawing at images, she found that they would start pointing to them. And so the idea so far is that that must be around the time when perhaps babies and toddlers are starting to understand that that represents something else, that they point to it as a meaning that it could represent something else that they want. So these are just, you know, some of her videos from her experiments. There's some really fun examples, and I mentioned many of them in the book, of kids up to the age of, say, 3 who see like a bowl of popcorn on screen, and when asked, you know, what would happen, how would you get the popcorn out of the bowl or whatever, they say, well, you just need to turn the TV over, you know, you just need to turn it upside down so the popcorn will fall out of the bowl. Like, there's just a lot of fascinating, clever experiments that get at how much children still don't necessarily see the objects on screen as being representative of something else. They think that they're a thing in and of themselves. So this is all part of this larger and burgeoning field of media literacy for very young children. And there's a lot more work to be done on this. In fact, if any of you here are graduate students who are interested in this, there's just a plethora of ideas for neat experiments and questions that you can start asking to get at, well, what do children at, say, before the age of three start understanding from media, and when do they start understanding it? And these are just a couple of the touchstone moments based on the research that we have so far on how young children are interpreting media. And I won't go through all this right now, but I'm happy to go back to the slide if anyone has questions on it. All right, pop quiz question number three. There's this thing out there called the video deficit. I wonder if any of you have heard of it, but we'll check. So is the video deficit a puzzling phenomenon in which toddlers are slower at learning via video? Anyone think so? No? Okay. Is it the difference between what baby video makers claim and what science says? Is it C, something that goes away with repeated video watching? Or D, the lack of training in child development that seems to afflict some video makers? So I understand, most of you are like, what? I don't know what to answer. And I can understand why, because it's a kind of a hard concept. So let me try to explain a little bit, and then I've got a slide that can help further. But the video deficit, basically the word deficit meaning that something is lacking, right? That we have a deficit in something. And the video deficit means that when young children are being asked to learn from video, and when I say young, again, I'm talking pretty much three and under, according to most of this research, some is a little older than three, they will not necessarily take away from that video what an adult might think that they can easily take away from it. And in very specific terms, let me tell you about one of the most well-known studies on the video deficit, and this can help maybe make it a little bit clearer. This is from a research out of Georgetown University by a woman named Rachel Barr. And she tried to figure out, okay, so could a baby learn from a demonstration on a screen the same way they might learn if I demonstrated something to them in person? And so she took a puppet, this little pink puppet here, this bunny, and she had some other puppets that she made as well. And she said, I want to do a little demonstration with this puppet. I'm going to put this puppet in front of a child's face. In one case, I'll do this in person. In another case, it'll be just on the video. And I'm going to have this puppet have a little mitten on its thumb. And I'm going to take that little mitten off, and I'm going to shake the mitten. And inside, it happens to be, there's a little bell that's been sewn into the mitten. And I'll shake the mitten, and I'll make a sound. And it's a very simple action. It's just demonstrating taking off that little mitten, shaking the mitten, and hearing the little ringing of the bell. So she did, and she and her research staff, did demonstrations in front of children face-to-face, where they would show the puppet, and they would take off the mitten. And then they would present the puppet to the babies, and they would see what happens. And invariably, the babies, even at young ages, I believe this is 12 months, would say, oh, yeah, I'll do that. And the babies themselves would grab for that mitten and shake it and hear the little bell. So obviously they learned from what they were seeing, this in-person interaction. However, the exact same situation shown on video with the same puppet using the same amount of time in between all of the different actions would leave babies just looking blankly. When the babies, after they saw the video, a minute or two later were shown the puppet, they just looked at it. They didn't even try to take the little mitten off and have the bell ring. And so something about the information that they were getting from that video was degraded. There was a deficit for them in terms of what they took away from that experience. Her further research, and research from many others, has shown that if you were to show that video multiple times, then it would start to kick in. And then the babies would, in fact, when presented with the puppet, try it themselves. So repetition can start to kind of overcome the video deficit. So what does this mean for like the real world and like the shows that children are seeing out there, right? And it has some real implications. What it means is that if there are shows that have some repetition in them, what we know from other child development research is that children often do need to see things a couple of times before they'll fully grasp it. Well, you may need to have that same repetition on screen. It also means that the social interaction that you as a caregiver, as a sibling, you know, an older sibling with children, as a parent, the social interaction you have with your children is so valuable. It's so important to them. They're really taking something out of that face-to-face interaction with you. And the video's not going to replace you. It just can't. I mean, that's why it's kind of really been puzzling to many people in child development fields when they see these baby videos that are marketed to young children. And it's almost as if parents think, oh, well, that would be better for my child than them watching me, you know, fold socks and talk to them while I'm doing the laundry. Well, actually, no. Them, like, watching you fold laundry as you, like, have a little conversation about what you're seeing and the colors that you're sorting and what you're going to do that day, that's better. But when we have to put in a video, and there are days when some parents feel like they are just going to go out of their mind, or maybe there's older siblings that are watching, you know, we're going to make decisions in which we're going to, of course, be putting, not of course, but in most families, it's kind of a part of the routine that you will be putting your children in front of video at some point or other. And I'm certainly one of those who used plenty of multimedia with my kids at young ages. So what are the videos that are going to make the most sense to them? Well, some research has shown that video deficit can start to go away, not just with repetition, but also if there's a character or a person on screen who's really interacting with the kind of the television audience, who's, you know, trying to kind of engage those that are watching by talking out to them, by saying, hi out there, or how are you today, or let's play a game together, and pausing a few times, and maybe, you know, obviously it's not a real face-to-face interaction, so it's not going to be as good, but it's something that gets children engaged enough to start learning. And some research out of Vanderbilt's shown that if children who show signs of participating with the person on screen are the same ones who could learn from what they saw on screen. In this case, it was a different kind of test than the puppet test, but they could still learn to some degree if they had a moment of engagement and interaction with the person on screen or the character on screen. And Blue's Clues is a great example of that. Many of you have probably watched Blue's Clues, right? And you know the moment when Steve or Joe stops and pauses and looks out on the screen, he's really interacting. A lot of this research points to some very particular things that we can look for in video for young children that could help them start learning from what they're seeing on screen instead of it simply being background TV to them, instead of it simply kind of going over their heads. And I do a lot of talks with preschools and talk to the parents of preschoolers, and they're always asking me, all right, okay, just tell me, what shows? What shows should I watch? What shows should I not? And it's going to change so much. I mean, even since I wrote my book, there's like 500, no, not that many, but there are actually 24 new shows since I wrote my book that are out there now. So what's more valuable is actually looking for particular traits and features of the video that will be of use to kids, that will engage them and help them learn. And I came up with this silly acronym, SPLEARN, and it's basically a way to remember some of these different traits to look for when you're looking at programming that's for young kids. And this is for 2 to 5-year-old children. Straight line storytelling is the first one. And who out there has watched Dora the Explorer? Got some Dora fans out there, maybe? So Dora the Explorer is a program that does have some child development research behind it. And the idea from the start was to allow young children to really be able to track what's happening on screen. And the way they did this was they first put out the map to show kids, okay, look, this is where we're going to go, from point A to point B to point C, over the river and through the woods, and, you know. And then also they made a very pointed effort in producing that show to make sure that Dora's pretty much always there. She's always on screen, and she's hardly ever, there's not moments where, you know, you clip, there's a quick cut to somebody else and suddenly she's not there. The kids can really follow her progression as she goes in this kind of straight line from point A to point B to point C. And research is showing that that's helping them pick up some language skills because they're following this narrative and they may be able to follow the story better and therefore they may be actually able to understand more of what they're seeing. Participation is what we just talked about, where you've got moments like in Blue's Clues where the kids actually can hear someone talking to them and answer back. And if any of you have been around, say, 3 or 4-year-old kids, particularly if there's more than one in the room and they're watching a show like Blue's Clues where there's moments where questions asked, kids will, most of the time, they will be shouting out answers. Some of the shyer ones, maybe not so much. Maybe if they're 2 years old, we don't see it as much. But from the research that I've done and from the research from Vanderbilt and the University of Massachusetts, kids are really talking back to the screen. And every time they're talking back, that's a moment of learning or a moment of showing that they've mastered something that they have learned. And you want to find labeling on screen. And I'm going to give you some examples of what this means in a second. It's just pointing to what you're talking about so that a child doesn't have just this word floating out there into Never Never Land that doesn't actually mean anything to them. And the word sharing is one that I'll show you in a second. Like, that word doesn't actually mean much to young kids if they're not actually given a demonstration of what it means to share something. E is for engaging ideas, which is kind of a no-brainer. R is for repetition and review, which we see in a lot of good preschool programming these days. And then N is nonviolent content. And I want to stop here for a second and just quickly say what I mean by that, because some people think, well, nonviolent content, well, of course, like, you know, kids shouldn't be watching CSI. Like, we get that. Although, I have to say, there are still many parents who will think that, my kid's not really paying that much attention to CSI. I'll just have it on in the background. But when I say nonviolent content, I mean just any show that has moments of aggression that are portrayed by characters on screen. So this could certainly include cartoons that are aimed at kids. Now, most of the time these days, we're finding that cartoons that explicitly say that they're for 2 to 5-year-olds try to be more careful about this, and they will not include moments of aggression. They won't show somebody being, like, kicked off a balcony. They won't show another character swooping down and grabbing someone by the shirt collar. But Cartoon Network and other channels like that really are not aimed at the 2 to 5-year-olds, but that show plenty of cartoon content, are portraying all sorts of shows that maybe at age, say, 8, 9, 10, children can really start understanding and picking up the motivations behind the characters, and they know this or that action is being done for this reason. But 4 or 5-year-olds, or even younger, certainly 3-year-olds, that motivation is probably not forefront in their mind, and what they're just picking up is what they're seeing on screen, and so then they're going to then want to imitate it. They're going to want to try it out. It's just human nature for kids at these young ages to want to then try to experiment with what they've seen and then do it later. So I heard from many social workers as I was doing the interviews for this book that they were having the hardest time on the playgrounds because a lot of kids were coming to the playground acting out what they'd seen on TV the night before. And it may have been something as, you know, seemingly harmless as Power Rangers, which, yes, has, you know, the good and bad characters, and for older kids, they may be able to pull out, like I said, they're understanding the motivations behind it, but these younger kids, 3, 4-year-olds, were just all about kicking. It was just all about, you know, running after someone and kicking and pulling them down. And what that means for caregivers, or any of you guys who want to go into, like, you know, early child education, it just means your job's harder when you have to do, you know, you're having to pull kids apart and say, no, we don't do that. And, you know, let's try to make our jobs as parents easier, try to make our jobs as teachers easier by giving our kids media that models the kinds of behaviors that you really do want to see and reinforce. So here are a couple of clips that I want to show that can just kind of demonstrate this a little bit. I'm not going to show all of this because it's quite long, but VeggieTales is a very sweet video program. It's often shown in churches because there's kind of an underlying kind of Christian religious message to it, but it's also, you know, in many other places too. And many parents see it as, it's going to be okay programming for my kid. If I have to pick some kind of DVD for my 3, 4-year-old, why don't we just put it in a VeggieTales DVD? Because it's all about good values. And there's some moments in VeggieTales that are quite funny. But I'm here to tell you that from what I understand in the research and from what we've even come up against since I wrote the book, there's very little evidence that VeggieTales could make any sense to children that are, say, under the age of 5. And it's because of the way it's designed. It's not designed for preschoolers. It's just designed for kind of children in a larger sense. And so it's not going to give them any kind of concrete information that they can kind of carry forward. My sense is, certainly from the interviews I did with parents, and I did interviews with scores of parents about what videos they're choosing for their kids and which one seems to make make the most sense or that they felt the best about, they'd say, oh, but this one's about, you know, this episode's about sharing, or this is a DVD that has a really good moral lesson, or this is a Disney movie that teaches them about, you know, the importance of family, and it's got a really nice moral at the end. But what they're not understanding when they choose DVDs like that is that the way the DVD is designed more so for parents and adults and children who have kind of reached a certain cognitive age to understand and grasp what is being talked about. So for us as adults, it seems like, oh, of course, you know, it's about sharing and it's kind of a riff on this Hamlet story. But for kids that still have not seen from that clip, they didn't see anything where a character actually took the eggs, sliced them in half, and gave, you know, part of the omelet to the other person. There was never a moment, and actually that clip goes on for well over 2 minutes. There's never a single moment in which a character actually truly shares something with another character. And at the end, actually, there's a very funny little moment where there's like the cucumber character and others sitting in the audience watching this presentation, and they say, did you understand a word of that? And I was like, no, I actually didn't. You know, they're kind of joking about the presentation, the performance, but I think that's kind of the way a lot of kids may come to something like that. Like, do they really get what that was about? So what's a better example? Well, nobody's perfect out there, honestly, in the children's media world. You know, producers have to find ways to kind of make things funny and engaging, and they try to have different plot lines that they think are going to bring kids in. And so it's not going to be exactly the same as what you might have in a really high-quality preschool classroom where you have a teacher who is being very explicit and concrete in the way he or she is talking about different objects that children are working with, or the way you might be able to talk about a particular action like sharing. However, there are some videos out there are some moments of multimedia that do a better job at that, that have some, that are based on some kind of child development research to understand, well, we need to be kind of obvious about this with kids. So here's one from, I'm going to toggle to the internet for a second here. SesameStreet.org just came out with their new website, and it's full of clips. It's just a really interesting resource. It's also just a fun way to relive your nostalgia for Sesame Street if you watched a lot of it when you were little, like I did. I am becoming aware of the time, and I'm going to slip through quickly a couple more of these slides, because I'd love to be able to take some questions as well, and see if any of this is kind of making sense, or if there's some pieces of it that you don't quite understand about what I'm talking about, or if you have questions about your own. And we can talk about movies if people want to ask some questions about what movies mean to young kids, so I'm going to skip through this. There's a lot to say about playtime and TV, and I went into some of that when we talked about background television. But certainly, one of the things that's kind of critical is the more that we learn about how much play matters to young children and how much it can help them with language development and social skills, the more we realize that having a TV off opens up some space for kids, some time to just kind of get into some of this pretend play. And if they're watching show after show after show, they're not going to have the kind of the self-control themselves. They're not going to understand that, oh, now it's time to turn that off and go do pretend play for an hour. You know, parents and caregivers are the ones who have to make that call for them. And I'm happy to talk about kind of what happens in preschool as well. But I have found that a lot of the longer programs, the full-day programs, many of them will say, oh, well, we use some videos, but we only use them sparingly, and oh, no, they're only during like nap time or during transition time or when we're waiting for the parents to come pick up their children. Well, I actually think it's kind of a real waste of using good video with kids. And if you could use it as multimedia story time, allow them some time to understand a well-designed show and then talk about it later and then use it in their play later, it could have some real kind of good reinforcement effects. So the mantra is the three C's: content, which we've been talking about, is what we see on screen. Context, is it background or foreground TV? Location of the TV can make a huge difference in terms of context. If it's like part of the dining room environment and the kids are just basically watching TV while they're eating, then you've lost all of your chances for real kind of social interaction there, to actually be able to just build some language skills with kids. And then how do parents and teachers refer to TV? If we're constantly saying, oh, this is my veg out time, this is when I'm going to do mindless things, this is when I'm not going to be thinking or learning, well, children are going to pick that up too. They're going to think, oh, well, that's what TV is. It's just, it's not about learning. Well, it absolutely can be about learning if it's used well, if we think about the context of it, and if we're finding high quality content to show them. So I am going to say thank you. I really appreciated your attention, and I'm looking forward to some questions. Thanks.